of India, they passed a judgment against the High Court of Gujarat that what verdict they gave was wrong. And I feel maybe it was the politicians whom have used the power. And imagine what we find after a couple of months. We have the Akshardham temple massacre. Two people were caught. They were killed. They're said to be Muslims. And the authority said that these people killed so many people in the temple in revenge, in retaliation. And they said that all this was nothing but retaliation. Islam does not justify that. They may have a logic. These people who did the attack, or the people who retaliated in other ways, they have a logic. They say that thousands of our family members were killed in front of eyes. Our mothers, our sisters have been raped in front of us. We have been looted. We know the person responsible is our neighbor, the person down the street. We meet him regularly. But when we see him, it reminds us of the torture. When they go to the law does not support. So they take the law in the hand. I am not justifying this act. Islam doesn't permit you. They take the law in the hand and they kill other innocent human beings. Islam does not justify that. They have a justification. They say, our mothers have been raped. We know the culprit. They are in front of us. No one is taking action. So they take the law in the hand. If you really find the culprit and book him, and if he's caught, if you can do that, and punish him, Islam justifies. You can't kill any other innocent human being. Islam does not justify that. You cannot use a wrong mean to come at the right goal. However much you may have sympathy for them, but the point to be noted, Islamically, it is wrong. It's not justified. Killing innocent human beings. Imagine the hundreds of innocent human beings killed by these people in retaliation. They in turn become enemies of Islam. What wrong have they done? It is the same thing. The earlier people killed innocent Muslims. No, you kill innocent Hindus. It's not justified in Islam. If you can catch the culprit, book him, punish him, fine. But not any innocent human being. Later on the 11th of July, we have, in this year 2006, we have a series of bomb blasts in the train. 7 bomb blasts in a span of 11 minutes, in which more than 200 innocent human beings were killed. More than 800 were injured. The police and the authorities, they say, this too was in retaliation to the thousands of Muslims killed in Gujarat. The authorities say it is the hand of the LET, Lashkar-e-Toyba. If you look at the sequence of events, could this have been prevented? Easily. Who's responsible? Number one, those politicians who had planned the burning of the coach in the Sabarmati Express at Godhra. They are responsible. Number two, the people at the center government, they could have stopped it, but they belong to the same party, they didn't know anything. Number three, the innocent citizens of Gujarat, they were instigated against the Muslims and they fell in the trap, they too are responsible. Number four, the police of Gujarat could have easily prevented, they didn't do it. They are responsible. And we know from records that most of the places, it was done under the supervision of the police. If you see the commission report, they too are responsible. Number five, the judiciary system of Gujarat. They didn't take action. Number six, the people who retaliated in the wrong way. The people who did the bomb blast. Islam does not justify that. They too are equally responsible. All six categories of people are responsible. But if we can prevent the first category, the first few categories, surely you will not have these terrorist attacks. And we know that in the past 1 month, thousands of Muslims have been harassed, mainly by the police. The police says it is mainly the Muslims who have done it. It is the hand of the LET, Lashkar-e-Taiba. I say, if you can really identify them, catch the people who are involved, we have no objection. But you can't harass thousands of innocent Muslims. Hundreds of them were rounded up. Hundreds of Muslims, they were detained for days and weeks together. As Justice Suresh said, that hundreds of them, they had been rounded up. Even their family was not informed. Imagine. And the thousands of innocent family members, they too have been harassed. We know about 22 to 25 so far, have been officially arrested. All of them, 100%, none of them, not a single arrested case is directly linked with the trained bomb blast of Bombay. All of them indirectly related to some other event. If you really catch the culprit, if you have proof, you have no objection. But at random picking up the Muslims, what signals are you sending? We know that about more than 300 innocent people were rounded up in Malwani. More than 300. For what? For interrogation. Any logical person will tell you that for interrogation, minimum, you at least require 3 or 4 policemen. If you want to do a proper interrogation, one policeman to threaten, one to have a soft approach, one to note down, maybe one to observe. At least 3, if not 4, minimum 3, for a proper interrogation. It takes minimum 1 or 2 hours. People, experts say 4 or 5 hours. I say minimum at least 1 or 2 hours. How many interrogation can you do? What is the manpower of the Malwani police station? What is the manpower? How many can they do in a day? 10, 20, 30, 40, how many? How many? What's the manpower? What's the force? Maximum 100, if you let it go. They round up more than 300 people, keep them waiting for the full day, then they take the telephone number and address and leave them. What signals are you sending? It is my request that the police should take the Muslims in confidence. Recently, after the bomb blast, there was a program organized by the non-Muslim. How we have Muslims have here on terrorism. Similar, there was a program organized by the non-Muslims on similar topics. Topic was different, but the issue was the same. By the non-Muslims. And the organizers had invited 2 ex-senior police officials from Bombay. Ex. One of them comes and blames the madrasa of Pakistan, the reason for terrorist attacks here. Second one comes and blames the madrasas of India. In the speech, you tell them that they should have computers, English, no problem, I'm with you. But to say that the Indian madrasas are directly or indirectly, even remotely associated with any form of terrorism in India is nothing but a blatant lie. Unfortunately for that police officer, there was one of the senior advocates in the audience. After the talk, he went and told him that, can you even give me a single white paper? Single proof that any madrasa in India has been proven to be associated with any terrorist act? He said, I don't know. Imagine what statement is the senior police officer giving to non-Muslims. What message are you sending? Hindus, in turn, will be against the madrasas. So making such irresponsible statements by senior police officers, see, I'm being careful, I'm not naming. Why? Because I'm a responsible citizen. What signals are you sending? I don't know of any madrasa in India. See, they are the center of learning. Fine, we may disagree. We may want English there. We may want modernization. I speak with the people of madrasa. I may have differences, have more education. Fine, have English, have computers. We agree. But to say that they are involved in terrorist activities, indirectly or directly, even remotely, is nothing but a blatant lie. So what is happening? What message are you giving? We know that hundreds of innocent Muslims are detained. Many were arrested. The police goes and does a search in the house. Then they find some books on jihad. Proof. Proof that involved in terrorist attacks. The Bombay media reported that these same books are being sold in the bookstores of Mohammadiyah Road for several years. If that was the case, why weren't these bookstalls closed down? Same books, jihad. I would like to tell that, do you know, the Quran too speaks about jihad. And almost all, every Muslim house has the Quran. Do you mean to say that you're going to arrest all the Muslims of Bombay?